The Empire pursues a cloning agenda. Clone Force 99 tries to find its place in the galaxy. Omega seeks a new purpose and more as the Sky Guys are back to review all of the Bad Batch.
All right, we are back here on the Sky Guys podcast. We are closing out the book on the Bad Batch. We took a little time to adjust after that series finale, digest it, and sort of have some thoughts on the whole series here. One of your hosts, Mike Phillips, with me today, as always, man, his voice you hear in narration every single week. Pete Consadori is here. Pete, how are you?
Doing well. I'm excited to talk to you guys about this and see what you guys think after letting the show or the season finale, series finale, kind of marinate a little bit. And yeah, I'm excited to talk about it.
Also here with us today, the man who's going to sneak off at the end of this podcast to become our public pilot, Nick Fraietta, is here. Nick, how are you?
Doing great. Our first ever series review, I believe.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, we didn't know if a multi-season, we'll say, because I guess technically we could count Obi-Wan and Boba Fett as series reviews.
True. Also, this is completely unrelated, but I want to just ask this question. Have you seen that Andor, the final season of Andor, season two?
Yeah.
Did we know that it was the last season?
Yeah, we knew that. Because I know that the production at the time said, like, this is way too much, like, way too complicated to do this for five whole seasons, the original intent was. They sort of mash it all together into two.
Oh, well, I saw that recently, and I was just like, oh, it's the last season. I wonder if we discussed that, but I guess we did.
Yeah, we definitely did here. And if you want to subscribe to this podcast, they can do so. Apple Podcasts, Google Play, TuneIn, Spotify, Amazon, all usual suspects. Simply search for the Sky Guys here, podcast platform. We've got all episodes there here. We are closing in on the Acolyte. It's only a couple weeks away, so make sure you're subscribed to get all the Star Wars content here. And Justin the Suffering, folks, you'll hear from us in that feed again soon, but you'll be delayed after the premiere.
Yeah, no, make sure you're subscribed so you're up to date. You're not waiting to hear it. It's going to be delayed, like Mike said. Definitely some really exciting stuff coming soon for you guys who are subscribed. It's free, doesn't cost you anything, so go ahead and click that button.
All right, and Nick, people want to subscribe on social media, how can they do that?
At Sky Guys Podcast on Instagram, Twitter, Threads, and TikTok.
Yep, you can go check out the YouTube version. Mike Phillips on YouTube. We got all the props and the graphics here, and for the last time in Bad Batch proper, Lego Omega has made her return.
Hello.
Yeah, this is also the young age version. We don't have the sneaking off as an adult version.
Maybe we'll get that one day, the whole Lego set.
And maybe we'll get a Lego set in the cave.
Maybe.
All right, so we have a little bit of Star Wars news here as well. Nick, you want to catch up what's been going on?
Yeah, number one is a New York Times article about Dee Bradley Baker, who's the voice of all the clones, reveals that there are no plans for any more clone-related shows, meaning as of now, this is the end of the Clone Wars era. We will see how long that stays true, but as of now, that is it.
I feel like they're going to take a break, Pete. I feel like they've beaten the clone thing to death so much, they might want some time to figure out what to do with these guys.
I'm happy about this. I think we've beaten this horse to death, so to speak. I just think that we need to move on.
Yep, we need to go on here. Nick, what else you got?
John Watts.
He's the showrunner.
Who is that, by the way? The showrunner of the Skeleton Crew?
Yeah, same guy as the director of the Spider-Man trilogy also.
The newest trilogy?
Marvel, the MCU one, yeah.
Okay. He says that the basic plot of Skeleton Crew is a group of kids that find a buried spaceship on their boring planet, accidentally turn it on, get blasted off into the galaxy. And a story about trying to find their way back home. And I'm assuming Jude Law's with them, or they find them, or he finds them, maybe.
I'm assuming he finds them.
Yeah, I mean, it actually sounds pretty interesting.
Yeah, although it makes you wonder with how long this show's been going, they've been like buried in the dungeon at Disney. Like, it makes you wonder if they must have no confidence in this thing.
I don't see why they would, to be honest with you. This sounds to me like, you know how, like, they have shows on Disney Plus that you would never consider watching, but it's based on something you know? For example, there's a National Treasure show.
Yeah.
But I watched the movie. I love National Treasure, the movie, but I would never watch the show. And I feel like this is, like, that version for Star Wars. It's like, oh, this is a Star Wars show, and it's just, like, a show that you would think has nothing to do with it. It's, like, slow budget, really bad, no one likes it, And it's just like it's just Star Wars because it's Star Wars. And I feel like that's the worst brand to do it for because Star Wars fans speak very loudly when there's something they don't like. But we'll see.
Pete, this comp, this premise grab you at all?
I feel like this has been done before in other applications. But I look, I'm curious about it. I will obviously have my opinions of it once it comes out and I see what it's all about. I'll also have my opinion on it, depending on if Hondo makes an appearance or not. However, on paper, at least it's a little bit different, right? So I can't be too upset about it.
Yeah. All right. That's true. What else we got, Nick?
Oh yeah, there's more. Disney Plus released a new teaser trailer for Lego Star Wars Rebuild the Galaxy, which is a four-piece special that will premiere on Disney Plus September 13th. And this is the Darth Jar Jar, right?
Yep, we got Darth Jar Jar, and we basically got the Star Wars What If universe with Legos. Bruce P, I saw the trailer. Basically, like a couple of the Lego Star Wars like characters they have in those cartoons that they we don't cover. Not like they sort of like found a magical timepiece and basically on it basically flipped the whole Star Wars universe upside down. And they had me at Darth Jar Jar. I was dying when he came out.
Yeah, have not seen that trailer yet. I feel like Nick and I are on the no trailer bus at the moment. However, it sounds pretty cool. Maybe I will watch it just because it's Lego Darth Jar Jar. But yeah, it intrigues me.
I think we should cover this in the podcast in the fall.
Yeah, I'm in. I think the Star Wars, the Lego Star Wars stuff's great. I love it. We did that one where it was like, what was like Finn and Rey went on vacation or something. What was that one? That
It's our vacation like
one
2 years
was
ago.
great.
Yeah. And we also had the one with Christian Slater and the biker gang. That was also fun.
Yeah, I really enjoy the Lego Star Wars specials, so I'm excited for this.
All right,
Silly,
so
they're not serious, and they're just fun.
yeah, it's a fun like probably 30 minutes, I would say.
Yep, and last is Cal Kestis minifigure is going to be included in a new Lego Star Wars Star Destroyer set that will be released on August 1st.
Heat, the price point on that is $160.
Okay, so that's probably a 1,000-piece set
I think roughly.
around there.
Yeah.
Star Wars, so it's gonna have a higher price tag for the piece count, maybe a 900-piece set. Yeah, that's pretty cool. Curious to see how that comes out.
Yeah, I'm gonna try and find it on here because they have the new one, which I'm going to try and find the piece count on the box of 1,555 pieces.
I was way off then. All right, so there you go.
It's about like a hundred, about like a like a dollar, like about what'd you say, trying to do the math here, like it's like a hundred, like $10 a piece.
No.
A dollar a piece.
No, because it was $1 a piece. It's 1,500 pieces. It'd be $1,500.
So I guess like
I'd be like 10 cents. I don't know what the math, 5 cents, 10 cents, something like that.
guess like
Just divide it up. People at home, you do it, you let us know
10.
because we're not good at math here. All right.
How much is the set?
$159.99.
And it's 1,500 pieces?
1,555 to be exact.
It's like, okay, 9 pieces every dollar.
Yeah,
Yeah,
Like
so
11
about
cents, like
10 cents a piece.
11, 10 cents a piece.
Okay.
We did it, guys.
We
Podcast
solved
is over. Thanks for listening.
the math problem. That it, Nick?
Yes, that is it.
All right. So let's get into our Bad Batch series review here. So now we've seen all of season three here. I think we're unanimous in the panel here, Peter. This was the best of the three seasons. Would you concur with that?
Yes, not a lot of filler episodes. It was a strong season when you look at it as a whole, as its own season. As it relates to the other seasons, I thought it was very, very strong. But I also just think they had a full story to tell this time. I feel like the other two seasons they were trying to stretch it out a little bit because they wanted to fill some time and stuff like that. This season, you can kind of tell they were really trying to get as much as they could into the 15 episodes. And it worked out. It was good. Except for the finale. And we discussed this, prior, and we'll get to it, I'm sure, in a little bit here. But yeah, strong season for me, and I think season three was the best season out of all three of them.
Yeah, I think for me, them having a final season and knowing ahead of time, I think helped this show because, like, I think like if this was as far as they wanted the story to go, like they would have dragged this out a long time. Maybe like a couple more seasons, might have been ambition afterwards, but like I think like we really trimmed the fat here in season three to get to the end point here.
Yeah, and I think that would have been a mistake if they really pushed it through. I think the Bad Batch showrunners knew this was only going to go 2 or 3 seasons. Let's make it 3 seasons because even season two, there was some good action, some really hard-hitting points in that season. But you can tell that they were just trying to get through the episodes they needed to hit for the standards that were put forth to Disney and everything like that. So, 3 seasons was plenty. You probably could have got it done in 2 seasons, or 2.5, or however you want to do it, shorter seasons. There was a lot of filler they could have just cut. But yeah, no, I agree. It was definitely a lot better that they knew this would be the final season.
Yeah, that's for sure here. And Nick, what did you think about season three as a whole?
I think it was the best season. I think it was good. I was at the edge of my seat throughout the majority of the season, and to me, that's good television. When the episode ended, I wanted to watch the next one. I was excited for the end of the show, not because I didn't like the show, just because I was excited to see what happens, and very happy about how the show went and the season and the season, to be more specific.
Yeah, that's for sure here. And obviously now we've had some time to reflect on the ending here of the whole show, where obviously you talk about this and 2 weeks ago on the pods, you can go back and listen to the full series finale recap. You want to hear that stuff. But Nick, now we've had some time to marinate. Does this ending get better for you? Is it worse? Like, is it about the same? How do you feel about the ending now that we've had some time to think about it?
After like having some time to reflect on it, I
Yeah.
think it's nice. It's just not what we expected. I think we expected to see people die, people not happy. And you know what? It wasn't bad. It was good, but it's just not what we expected.
Yeah, for sure. And Pete, the way I sort of look at this finale was sort of like, okay, like we clearly, I think, changed the plan, what we had in mind for these characters based on the fact we cut the series short after 3 seasons. Whereas like Fallen Wars went 7, Rebels went 4. I think this is sort of like, okay, we need to like kind of tie everything in a bow and just park these characters somewhere. If we ever want them again, they're here, but we don't have to deal with them. We don't want to. So I think that's sort of the theory I have with the finale.
I mean, it's a good theory. I still stand behind what I said when we did the finale podcast. I think it was a good finale for a season, or it was a good actual episode. However, I think it just didn't give it much meaning. It gave the whole show not as much meaning. If you want to park characters there to be used later, I agree. If you want to show Omega getting older and showing what happens after, I agree with all that. And the action was great and everything. But to me, when you don't put a bow on really big things and you just kind of glance over them like they did, it just delegitimizes the reason why they had the show to begin with. So, think of one of your favorite shows and how they end, and think about if they just went over a couple of the key points and they just kind of glazed over it and ended the show, if you would be upset about that and go, oh yeah, no, that was a great season finale or series finale.
I think there's a big differentiator though, Pete, between like, well, I think this case more of a case of like they knew they were ending and this is what they chose compared to like a show that gets the rug pulled out from and is canceled when they clearly had plans to go on.
I'm sorry, say that again.
I think your point is accurate for this show. Like, I don't think you can generalize all shows that way. There's definitely a lot of shows, especially like on broadcast networks, where they just get canceled
Oh,
and then they right the creators had no intention of ending the show where they did, so they kind of get stuck.
for sure. I mean, like one of the shows. I mean, this is spoiler alert for everyone out there who hasn't seen How I Met Your Mother. I'm just gonna say to for all of that work that Ted puts in to find his wife, for everything that happens in that show for it to end the way it does,
It's very bad.
it's one of those endings like it just delegitimizes the whole show, right? It's a very like, oh, come on. To me, yes. Do you want to give away everything about Project Necromancer? No, because you probably want to show that later. I'm sure they're going to show it in the
Coming up.
Mandoverse. I'm sure they're going to expand on it. But give us something that legitimizes what is going on here and not just, well, we saved Omega so she can become a rebel, like we knew she was going to do anyway. Like, it doesn't, like, this whole, to me, these 3 seasons just meant nothing. If you never produced this show, we already know there's cloning. We already know what's going on, that the Emperor has come back somehow in episode 9. We know that there might be clones of Moff Gideon. We know all this from media that's already out there. So to me, if you don't give us more, where we already know this stuff is happening, it's just like, what did we do here for 3 seasons? That's where I'm coming from.
Yeah, Pete, before we move on here, the How I Met Your Mother thing, definitely a great point on that show as well, because, I mean, like you could tell, like, they thought they were ending with 8 seasons. The fact that the last one, completely side tangent, but we spent the whole season in a flash forward, only to undo the entire flash forward, the last episode, like,
100%.
Yeah.
100%. And I just feel like sometimes, I mean, even Game of Thrones, the whole last season, I think sometimes ruins how the show was for people. So I feel like it is very important, and to glaze over very, very important storylines of the seasons that you've had for the past however many years people have been following it is a mistake in any show, not just Star Wars.
Yeah, and Nick, I want to bring up the point Pete brought up here. It's actually where we're going to go next here, which is like we obviously now see the full picture of what they did with Clone Force 99, with Omega, with some of these other dangling plot points you have from Clone Wars kind of got picked up here to some degree. But, like, do you feel like that we gain anything meaningful from the Bad Batch experience? Like, if Pete said, like, if this show did not exist, would we be missing out right now?
Before we get into that, I love How I Met Your Mother. I kind of forgot that show existed, and I want to watch it again. That was a great show. It was a really good show. Any random episode in a random season, the end wasn't as good, sure, but it wasn't terrible. The end, like, you know what I mean? Like, the episodes were still good.
The ending was god awful.
I don't think it was. I think the ending was fun, but it was like a great show. I'd pick up any episode of that show, and I would love to watch it.
Yeah. We'll continue the discussion off air, but in terms of the, you feel we gained anything meaningful?
But I do think we gained something meaningful in the Bad Batch, in that the whole Project Necromancer thing failing. I mean, I guess we didn't need it because we know that the clones in episode 9 don't turn out to be successful, but seeing how, like, their research was stalled and how it took so long to get it back going, Mandalorian kind of like shows why it was unsuccessful. So that's an interesting piece to take with you if you're a Star Wars fan. But I guess it wasn't needed. You just have to know it didn't work for the end, or they lost the information, I guess.
Yeah, Pete, like, in terms of, like, an animated Star Wars show, like, were there fun moments? Sure. But I think I agree with you on the point that, like, for what we got in this show, like, there's nothing we really couldn't have surmised without the show's existence. Like, obviously, we know that the clones get phased out for the stormtroopers. We learned that in the show. We know that the cloning efforts of the Empire did not work originally, and we learned that in the show. Like, we saw a little bit of Clone Force 99. We didn't get a ton of them, like, being, like, super badasses most of the time. We got, like, when most of the show prior to season 3 is them doing odd jobs for Sith, I think that's a problem.
Yeah, I mean, I kind of disagree that we got something meaningful. I mean, I think that all of the things they were talking about, we knew existed in some capacity from Star Wars projects we've been watching for how long we've been doing this podcast. And to me, if you're going to bring it up and then be in the heart of it, what Hemlock is doing, like, he is literally the guy that is making this all become a thing, and you don't, like, you literally, it was almost like on a player, right? Rampart asks Nala Se, tell me about it. It cuts, and then they come back to Rampart going, huh, and then blowing up. Like, it was almost like a smack in the face a little bit. It was like, we're going to have it being talked about by characters that you're not going to hear, but we're not going to let you know what's going on, even though you've been waiting for 3 seasons to figure it out. That, to me, is where I'm like, meaningful how? Yes, I agree with Nick. We find out why it takes so long and maybe why it didn't work out. But that literally could have been a 30-second dialogue in a different show about, like, we tried this once before, but Clone Force 99 blew up our thing or whatever. And that's all you need to know. We don't need 3 seasons to figure that out. That's all I'm going by.
Yeah, and Nick, I do think also part of the problem here is that this sort of felt like Filoni had unfinished business at Clone Wars and he created this. And then he said, oh, I'll use these random clones I introduced in season 7 to continue the story threads. And he ends up leaving the project and it gets picked up by the current showrunners. I think Jennifer Corbett's the main showrunner on Bad Batch here, and then like they really had no idea what they wanted to do with these guys most of the time.
You gotta think though that when season 7 of Clone Wars came out, we were introduced to the Bad Batch. The show was already well underway,
Yeah.
right?
Yeah, I mean, season 7 came out in 2020. They get the Bad Batch itself the next year.
Yeah, so I think this was it was just a way to introduce them, which is kind of annoying. You know, 4 episodes introduced them, but whatever.
Yeah, but my issue is more that like we're here now, what are we doing? And I feel like at least the first like season and a half, we sort of like just sort of wandering around aimlessly trying to figure out what to do with them.
Yeah, we didn't have much. It was what people wanted, which is always blew my mind. All threads I would see online of what movie or Star Wars show do you want? It was always a group of rogue clones that survived Order 66. And I'm like, that's literally what we got. And it was I don't and I'm not saying I didn't like the show. I liked the show, but like this is literally what we got, and it was underwhelming. I liked the show. I grew to love the characters and love the story and what we're going for, and thought the ending was really good. And I think the Bad Batch was very successful, but it was underwhelming.
Yeah, at least also put it to you this way, P. I feel like I said this prior to season 2. I think it took until about halfway through this season 3 for our guys to really be driving the action forward instead of reacting to what's happening to them. And that's a problem.
I agree, and I think it's also a problem that we just had them retire, and all you hear is see is Hunter. You don't hear from Crosshair, you don't hear from Wrecker. It's almost like, well, Hunter was really the character you should have been following. If that's the case, have Crosshair and Wrecker die. Make some meaning to the character, right? Like, not to say there was no meaning of Hunter, but where is the meaning behind their characters if you're not even gonna show them getting older? It was just Hunter and Omega. Like, it was just them. Like, I thought Wrecker was super close with Omega, but Omega's sneaking out, not saying goodbye to him. You know, it just seems very, like, again, delegitimizes everything. And I just want to make sure this is clear. I liked this show, just like Nick. I liked this show, but underwhelming. I think he put it perfectly.
Yeah, I mean, I'll put it this way. We'll get to it when we talk more about the episode rankings later on here. This is the show we've had by far the lowest ratings on a specific episode. We had a 2.16 in season 2. Like, that's very hard to accomplish.
Which one was that?
That was the one where they were treasure hunting with Fee.
Yep, I remember that one.
Because that was a case, I think, of them sort of spinning their wheels. They sort of had no idea what they wanted to do with these characters for a bit. So we need to kill, like, fill an episode for the runtime. All right. And another point that Pete brings up here, we had a lot of unanswered questions from this show specifically. So I want to run through, I came up with 7 off the top of my head. You guys want to add to any of these and add on any extras? What we missed, what bothers you the most here? So here's my generic list of unanswered questions. So, number one, what happened to Cody after we saw him in season 3? In season 2, he has dips and we never see him again.
Yep, surprising. No idea.
This is the one I think annoys Pete more in line with the Hemlock, more with the one at the Rampart Knowledge Day conversation. What exactly did Palpatine get shown in the vault by Hemlock?
Wish I knew.
I mean, are we expected to think it's those shadow trooper guys at the end?
I'm guessing that's what
Because I felt like the vault looked different. It wasn't like a vault of 4 or 5 areas. It was like just this one thing. Like this was the thing that we're working on.
Yes.
I mean, I could be wrong. Maybe I didn't connect that, and maybe that's the vault, right? Maybe they did explain it, and that's what it was. And I'm completely off base for what I'm saying. But to me, it seemed like it
A different ball.
was it the clone of Palpatine that they were working on? Was it Moff Gideon? Like, what was it? Like, what exactly was it? I mean, Moff Gideon's definitely not, that's a not a correct statement to make. But you know what I'm saying? Like something, like singular, not like 4 or 5 in a row, you know? So that's kind of where I got confused.
Yeah, I think Nick, if that was the intention, that it was going to be Palpatine was shown the Shadow Clones, did a very poor job of illustrating that to us.
Agreed. I don't know. I have nothing else to add.
Next one here. Remember, for first season's Lama Su, the Prime Minister of Kamino, like he's a prisoner of the Empire. He just vanishes after season 2. We never see him again.
True.
You know, he says the deal, like, oh, like I'll be out if you get Omega, and then we never hear from him again. So I guess we're supposed to assume that he just gets let out and they don't kill him. But okay.
Guess so.
What happened to Wolf? And this is like one they introduced this season, like where Wolf lets them go and then he's not ready to leave yet. And like, why do we even bother doing that if we're not going to address this again?
Yeah.
Ventress, Max Roberts' favorite character. And like, this again felt like very unnecessary to where we went this season.
How the hell do you show Ventress in a trailer and build her up to be in 15 minutes of the season?
That's exactly the point.
To answer a question.
I mean, yes, I understand you want people to get hyped up for season three, but the way that they advertise this was that Ventress was gonna be like our predictions was like Ventress is gonna be trying to find Omega, and we're gonna get all these story arcs with Ventress going after them. We got Ventress for 15 minutes,
Yeah.
maybe not even. I mean, to me, that's the biggest flop of the season.
I mean, that is the biggest flop. I mean, Nick, that was the last shot of the trailer was Ventress.
Yeah, it's not surprising to me. Same thing as Vader and Tales of the Empire. Draw you in with the jingle key of you know who this is, watch our show now, and we'll show them to you for 2 or 3 seconds, and you're gonna keep coming back, come back, come back until you find what you're looking for, like Cad Bane.
Yeah, Cad Bane was very jingle keys in this show also, but I mean, the balls this show had to bring Ventress back to be a glorified encyclopedia and then not bother telling you how she survived her death in the book, that's ballsy. I gotta give them that, Nick.
Yeah, it was.
All right, so let's go now to next answer question here. And this is, I think, in terms of the show itself, this would be frustrating if you were a diehard Bad Batch fan. How Echo just dips and is never heard from again, even in the epilogue, they don't address where Echo's been up to. So that was a very, very strange call.
It almost seems like it's setting up because your next one. And this one maybe go hand in hand. You're number seven if you want to get to it real quick, and then I'll bring up my point.
Yeah, number seven is Rex's clone network, which you were promised he several times throughout the show.
I'm wondering if they're just together and we get some sort of show in the future. I know they said there's no plan for it as of now, but we get a show in the future on, this takes place when right after End of the Sith, maybe like 2 years, and then the epilogue is how is right up to the.
It's in Rebels timeline.
Yeah, but maybe you get a show somewhere in the middle of there and they show Rex in that time period.
Yeah, Pete, does the Echo just dipping bother you, the fact they never like address him in even the epilogue?
I mean, all of these clones that don't get addressed afterwards, and I'm not talking about Wolf, I'm talking like Wrecker, Crosshair, like main characters of the story. Even though Crosshair was bad for a season and a half, for 2 seasons. Very big character of the story to just be like, we're ending it. They retired on the island. Oh, okay. I guess everything's happy. There were so many things about Wrecker, Crosshair, and Echo that they could have, actually done, but they didn't.
Yeah, and Echo, it just sort of felt like they gave up on him in the middle of season two, because once like he leaves with Rex to go help Rex's mission, like we barely see him the rest of the way.
Yeah, right.
Because they decided, like went back to the season one problem with Nick, who says that, oh, like Tech and Echo are the same character. So they sent Rex off, they developed Tech, they killed Tech off, and then we never got Echo back.
You're right.
Which I that would frustrate me, just in terms of like somebody who's invested time in the show is like he's one of the main five, and then like he's just off like saying, oh, I'm helping Rex, and then we just don't get any closure on him.
I think we're gonna get more. I do. I know it's not announced yet, but I think we're gonna get more.
Maybe like they might take a 2-3 year break when they come back to these guys.
Yeah.
Come back to me after we're done with all the things that they're not explained and what Nick said that we're definitely coming back to a or having another show or something. Just come back to me on that.
All right. So, any other unanswered questions you guys can think of aside from like the ones I threw out there?
Little like nonsense ones like where's Cad Bane from now until Boba Fett? But that doesn't count. Like that's not this show's responsibility to answer.
No, it's not their
That
responsibility.
is a question that I have, but that's not their responsibility to answer.
I don't think so either. I think like maybe a little bit of like the whatever Chuchi's up to, we get a little tease of that. But again, that's sort of really outside the show's purview a little bit.
That's all I want to know. I want to know what happened to all the senators. That's why I love Andor so much.
So you get hints of it, basically.
Yeah.
I mean, we see the Senate building in Andor. We got in there for a couple of minutes at Bad Batch points.
Yep. Love that.
Were you surprised that we didn't get Vader or Ahsoka in this show?
I'm surprised we didn't get Vader in the finale just for a second. That's it. Ahsoka, I didn't expect to see.
I mean, based on Tales of the Jedi, I'd be surprised Ahsoka is popping around this time. She's kind of staying underground at this point.
Yeah, I just thought we'd get Vader at the way end.
Thought you just walk in and stand next to Palpatine just to say, "Oh, I'm here." Pete, any other unanswered questions you have?
No.
All right. So, next question before we get to our trackers and whatnot, but we start to keep track of the end of the series here. It's like, do you think we see any of these characters again? Because again, as far as we know, Echo is in the ether somewhere. We don't know where he is. Omega is flying off, is sneaking off to join the Republic as a pilot, join the Rebellion as a pilot. The other three are retired on Pabu, and Batcher's hanging out with them on Pabu. Do we see any of these guys again, Pete?
I don't know. And this is the point I wanted to make when I said come back to me. I feel like Star Wars is getting into the curse of Marvel where you need to watch so much content to understand what the next thing's about. And I think we're getting to that's why I think we need to get out of this timeline and we got to get away from these characters. I think that if Star Wars and Disney wants to be successful with the Star Wars brand, they need to make something new so that when someone watches it, like Mandalorian, they don't need to know anything. They can just watch it and watch the story from start to finish and grow with the character. If we bring back these characters in any capacity, it's such a deep cut now to understand what's going on that if you're not a huge Star Wars fan, and I mean huge, where you're watching every bit of content that comes out, you're not going to understand how they got to that point, who they are, and what the significance of them are. And I think that's where a lot of Star Wars content struggles, and that's where they're going to struggle in the box office maybe when it comes to Mandalorian Grogu or like the Dave Filoni Avengers movie. They need to just stick with one thing, start to finish, and actually start it and actually finish it. So I kind of hope we don't get these characters again. I hope we actually go to something new like we are with the Acolyte and just start something new and have people grow with it.
Yeah, Nick, I do feel like they might be heading on that path. We're not going to see these guys again, especially because we got the interview with Michelle Ong, who voices Omega. She said that, look, like Omega originally had a bigger storyline in the Star Wars universe, and they changed it. So that made it sort of feel like, okay, like they're kind of like parking this character because I don't think they have any big plans for it anymore.
Maybe not, but maybe they just wait and see how the reaction was and then decide to throw her into something. Like they could easily have something in the idea box that hasn't begun yet. And they can just say, oh, people seem to like Omega by the end of the show, which by the way, how do you guys feel about Omega? I have no issues with Omega at the end of the show. Similar to our Ezra, our Ahsoka, that's our animated protagonist to its beginning. We're like, seriously? And by the end, no issue at all with the character. So another one that they've done well with making us, a character grow on us. So I wouldn't be surprised if in the future they said, hey, throw her in there. People liked her.
Yeah, that's for sure here. So, anything else you guys want to add before we go to our trackers and our MVP boards and whatnot?
No, nope.
Pete, you're good?
I'm good.
All right, so let's go to our trackers here for the final time. So, just go through all six we had going to season three here. Hondo did not show up in this season or the entire show. So, we have 18 Hondos, Nick.
Oh, 18 condos ever.
Ever.
Oh, okay, right. That makes sense.
Maybe we'll get lucky to find him somewhere something you haven't watched yet, but as of right now, 18 Hondos.
Makes sense to me.
All right. So live action cameos mentioned last week, Pete. We had four for the entire season. We had Palpatine, Fennec, and Tarkin twice. So four in season three, which is not bad considering that the earlier seasons kind of went overboard on the cameos.
I agree.
Nick, I know you love the planet trackers. We end up with 12 planets for season three. So 12 in season three for Curiosity. Season two went to 15. So 27 planets visited in two seasons.
Or some of them crossover though, probably, right?
Probably. Even though that's probably like, what, like 23? They're probably the same.
Over under for the season was 9.5. So if you bet the over, you're doing well.
P, as we mentioned here, named clones. We had 40 of them over the course of the season, so they love this. They love this one.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there was definitely a bunch. Again, not bad. Season was good, so I'm okay with it.
15 of the 40 were Embry Carr and Scorch. And Nick, did you know the backstory of Scorch allegedly?
No.
Apparently, he was a character they pulled from a video game, I think, called like Star Wars Republic Commando, and like the internet was losing its mind when they just had Scorch do nothing.
I didn't know that. I know that game though. That game, I believe, is free on PlayStation now.
Yes, I'm trying because I think Scorch is like one of the main guys in that game.
That game came out in like 05, so it must, yeah, he is, but that must not be canon game. But they turned the character.
I didn't just pluck the character out of the game and just threw him in this thing with a new origin.
Yes. Yeah. But yeah, that is that game is free on PlayStation now.
Yeah, so I just think it was funny the internet was exploding because the people were mad. They just had Scorch basically stand there and do nothing.
Yeah, well, I mean that's what happens when you take a beloved character of a video game and I'm stand there and do nothing. I'm sure the same thing would happen if they had Cal Kestis in like a scene just sitting there and it's like, well, wait a minute. It's like one of the coolest Jedi characters in video game history, and you just have him sitting at a bar or something. So I get it.
Yep. And Nick, next thing here, we had two Rex missions all season, which was activating the data pad on Barton 4 and protecting Omega during the Imperial raid. So just two Rex missions.
That is good. The less, the better.
All right. And last but not least, Pete, we mentioned this last week, 11 named deaths in season three. So that's about what we expected. Maybe a little higher, we thought.
Yeah, I mean it's still a lot in 15 episodes, so.
All right, so now we'll get to our MVP board here. So we're gonna do first, I had the board for season three, then Nick, I pulled the entire series together. So
Let's see it.
I went back like to season one to I found our season one data like back from the day we were doing this once a month. So I had that figured out as well. So let me get first the MVP board for season three. So let me go ahead and pull that up. So share on the screen here. As we mentioned last, I'm not gonna go through the whole thing because our top three characters on the board here were Shadow Clone number two was the MVP of season three. According to us, he was a plus five. Then there was a Ventress, Crosshair, and Emery Carr tied for second at plus four. So would you guys agree those are the best, the most valuable characters of the season?
Yeah, I would say so.
I feel like Hunter is so low on the list, but oh, we'll get there when we do the LVPs, I guess. But Omega, I feel like, should be a little bit higher, and Ventress maybe lower. But Ventress, I mean, it's made such a an impression, you know?
Her one episode, she swept the points.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then our LVPs, the bottom three, Wrecker, negative three, K9X1, the droid who gets blown up twice in the premiere, negative four, and then Imperial Security brings up the rear at negative 10. So that's the LVP side, the bottom three. So any thoughts on that?
Yeah, Hunter should not be that low at all. Hunter had a very strong end of the season, and we tried to get him out of the negatives, but it wasn't enough. Hunter should deserves to be like in the Echo area of like one of the higher ones, like towards the middle. But he had a bad early on in the season, so it's unfortunate.
Yeah, Hunter, I'll also point out, Pete, there were a couple of episodes where it was like only the team there, and like he's having to be the worst of the team in those episodes. That's why he got ended up where he did.
Yeah, and I mean, I also think that you get, characters that show up a lot more. They kind of get screwed over in a sense because, like, Fennec Shand at a plus two, Ventress at a plus four in the second spot. Again, she was in the season 15 minutes. So she's always going to be in a positive if she only shows up for one episode because we all were like, we loved Ventress, MVP point. So I think that we have to take these lists like with a grain of salt because a lot of these characters only show up once and there's really nothing to balance them out.
Yep, and also one more time, I gave Max Roberts half the go to squid me on the LEP side. That's always hysterical. I look at that list.
Which again, higher than Hunter.
Is higher than Hunter. Now let's go to the whole series MVP board. So this one is a very long list here. So I'll put this up on the board. People on the YouTube version, my fellows on YouTube can see this whole thing here. The most valuable character in the series, according to us, was Dr. Hemlock at +8. Nick, does that surprise you?
No.
He had
No, that's not us.
a monster season two. Remember, he think he finished season two at the top of the board, like plus like, top of the board.
No, like I'm just looking at the list as a whole here, and I'm looking at like the top three or four, and I'm looking at like the bottom three or four, and I'm like, looks good, except poor Wrecker and Omega down there. Like I feel like they're good characters, and it's unfortunate that they're toward the bottom there.
Yeah, I'll go through like one side at a time here. Some of the more normal ones here. The positives, the tops are Dr. Hemlock is +8. Tech and Crosshair tied for second at +7 overall. Shadow Clone number two in his one season made +5. Then Emery Carr and Ventress +4. This I think the problem with the show here, Pete, you can see some of these characters show up once and outshining our main guys. I mean, look at, for example, Ventress +4. Cody in his one episode +3. Gungi +2, Benny the Thief +2. I mean, what does that tell you?
I mean, look, unfortunately, I think that it tells us that unfortunately these main characters had more bad writing than the one-off characters, right? Let's be honest. Ventress had a very strong episode. If Hunter was a well-written character throughout all the seasons, he wouldn't be in the negatives. Right, and or at least in season three wouldn't be in the negative, right? If Wrecker was a well-written character, if Omega was not, you know, whatever, these main people would be up there. So it just kind of shows you that these one-off characters, when they're there, they have strong episodes, but these long-term characters sometimes have worse episodes than they do good, which I think kind of shows the direction of how the show is.
Yeah. So I think in terms of that, I'll also mention here, there's some other fun shout-outs here. We're on the MVP board because I gave us a point. We watched a terrible episode in season two. So that's how we're on the board. We are actually rated higher than Omega and Wrecker ourselves.
Whose motto?
He was one of the random bad guys in early season two.
Not Pelly?
Not Pelly.
Kid.
It's her cousin.
Yeah, Kevin Kiner is on the MVP board because Nick gave him credit for the sound in the premiere of season three.
Oh yeah, the score is fantastic in this show. O only in the good episodes.
Yeah, some notable negative ones here. Omega was +3 in season three, a negative three overall. It tells you the hole they buried her in the first two seasons.
Same with
Wrecker.
I mean Wrecker was bad in season three also, but like I feel like where's Hunter by the way? +1, yeah.
Hunter and
I
Echo
just feel
both
like
plus.
the Bad Batch, meaning like T Tech and Crosshair were really good characters, but like Echo, Hunter, Wrecker, and Omega really came on at the end, and it was just a little too late for them to catch up and be out of the negatives.
Yeah, and you look here too, it tells you the characters we developed are the best ones of the team.
Yeah.
Yeah, and on the bottom of the board here, I'll list here again. The Empire, Imperial Security, which we really dinged this season because they were awful, and the bane of the show, Sid at -12, which of course the season without Sid is the one that's the best one.
Yeah, no Sid. But Sid's still alive, so.
She got an LED point from me for this season for selling the team out again, but
Yeah, we gotta get her dead.
So Pete, you happy where Sid is?
Yes, 100%. Worst part of the show by far.
She is worse on this board than Karn is on the Andor board.
All right, yeah, so again, that's pretty bad.
I kind of feel like, and I know we're not gonna make changes now, but the Empire and Imperial Security should just be combined to the Empire. But I know we specifically went out of our way to not do that. We're not going to change it now.
Yeah, I think it's more the Empire for being like morally awful, and the Imperial Security is the security guys failing to do their jobs.
Right.
I know Max gave the Empire an LVP point. I think Joe gave the Empire LVP point. Joseph only showed up for his one episode, so All right, so next up here, the last thing we're going to do here is we're going to go to the season three episode rankings here. So would you like to start from the bottom, Nick, or you want to go with the start at the top?
Bottom.
All right, so let me pull up first here the bottom eight episodes I had in here. So the worst episode of the season was a 5.25 for the hard year. That was the Asajj Ventress episode.
Look at that.
Yeah. Then Parts Unknown is second to last. That's episode 5.5. Then we jump up to Flash Strike, episode 14, the penultimate episode is 6.67. Episode 4, Different Approach, is 7. Then a three-way tie for 9 between Infiltration, 7.17, episode 6. Episode 8, Bad Territory, 7.17. Also, episode 13, Into the Breach, 7.17. So any surprises here?
I mean, to me, the bottom episodes are still a very high rated episode, right? Five is average. So a seven is a pretty good score. Even the 6.67 is a pretty good score. And listen, the bottom two episodes are in the average range. Nothing was below average. So kind of shows you that it is still a strong season, even though we don't maybe agree with, or I don't agree with a lot of the choices they made.
Yeah, for comparison, I'm going back to season two. Look at our grades here. That episode was better than one, two, three, four, five episodes in season two.
Right. So I think it helps that there were no Sid missions. I'm sure all those were Sid missions.
Most of them were. And you ready for the top half?
That's it.
All right. Top half. I feel like I'm echoing somewhere. I don't know what it is, but let's go here and pull that up. Episode. Okay, so the top episode of the season was Point of No Return, which was the second half of the double. We got a 9.25. I had that typed in wrong. Shadow of the Tantus was second, episode 3, a 9 flat. Identity Crisis, episode 10, 8.88. Episode 7, Extractions at 4, 8.33. Episode 5 is the premiere, 7.67. Tie for sixth, we have a two-way tie between episode 5, The Return, episode 12, The Juggernaut, is the Fiji Analyte Treasure Hunt side quest. And the finale is dead in the middle at 7.33. So any thoughts on the rest of the list?
Not really.
I mean, for me, the season finale should be the top-rated episode. Series finale should be the top-rated episode. And
It's
it's
still the
not.
pack. It's the middle of the
It's
pack.
middle of the pack. So that is kind of where I'm coming from. I think that, not to say that validates my feeling, but it just makes me feel a little bit better of like it wasn't like top three. It was literally number eight. So it just it if you have a good show or whatever and you're trying to wrap up a lot of points and you can only manage to get eighth out of 15, to me, it's not a successful series finale.
Yeah. To me, it sort of goes back to the point made earlier here where they kind of had run knew they were running out of rope here. Because like once we got past Omega getting caught again and surrendering again, like the story really slowed to a crawl. It really dragged out the ending of them trying to get her back.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, so that's all I got here. Any final thoughts?
No, none for me.
Only thing I want to reiterate is I still liked it, even though I didn't agree with the series finale.
Yeah, I would say again, solid show, like definitely enjoyable, but I think it falls in the Tales of the Empire book that I talked about last week. It's sadly not essential to like the true Star Wars experience. Like, there's nothing we learned in here that's like earth shattering compared to like some of the reveals we got in these movies or Clone Wars or Rebels.
Right.
All right. That's it for Bad Batch coverage here. Coming up next week, we're going to start getting into Acolyte mode here. We're going to do a special podcast. We're going to sort of take a look into what the High Republic is, this whole multimedia project that's Star Wars been doing the last couple of years. So, Pete, we're going to take a little dive into exploring a little about what this is, what's out there, if you want to get into it, and some things you might want to be aware of before you head into the Acolyte.
Yeah, no, I'm very excited for that discussion. I'm very excited for the show. So, it's something I'm looking forward to.
That sounds good. We're looking forward to having that conversation next week. I want to thank you guys for coming on. As always, appreciate it. Pete, people follow you on social media. How can they do that?
at Consy29 on Twitter, CONSY29, APTyler308 on Reddit created this background, so make sure you check them out.
All right. One more time, Nick. People want to follow us on social media. How can I do that?
At Sky Guys Podcast on Instagram, Twitter X, Threads, and TikTok.
Yep. You can also follow me on social media, MPhillips331. It's MPHILIPS331. This week over on the Just Send the Suffering Podcast, we're going to preview the PGA Championship with Andy Martini of the PGA Tour. Get ready for that. And depending on if the NFL gets the schedule on time, you'll either hear from Nick Fraietta on the Just Send the Suffering Podcast this week or next week. We haven't decided yet.
When are they planning to announce it?
We do not know yet.
Really? I thought we would have known. Wow. All right.
The rumor was Thursday, but they may not be doing it. They may wait till next week to do it from day recording.
I hate how we talked about this last year. They say, oh, it's going to be announced at Thursday, 8 o'clock, and by Thursday at 7 o'clock, you know all the games. I hate that.
It's going to happen again, too. You know that.
Yep, of course it will.
All right, so that's it for us. We'll be back next week to explain what the High Republic is to the people uninitiated. But until then, may the force be with you.